often of Thomas Jefferson's vision of an American democracy rooted in tens of thousands of independent freeholds owned by family farmers. And I don't want my kids to grow up in a world where we've paved Florida and the Everglades, and we've lost touch with the seasons and the tides and the things that connect us to the 10,000 generations of human beings that were here before there were laptops, and that connect us ultimately to God. And I don't believe that nature is God, or that we ought to be worshiping it as God. But I do believe that it's the way that God communicates to us most forcefully. God talks to human beings through many vectors, through each other, through organized religion, through the great books of those religions, and through wise people, and through art and literature and music and poetry, but nowhere with such force and clarity and detail and texture and grace and joy as through creation. You know, we don't know Michelangelo by reading his biography. We know him by looking at the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel. And we know our Creator best by immersing ourselves in creation, and particularly wilderness, which is the undiluted work of the Creator. And if you look at every religious tradition throughout the history of mankind, the central epiphany always occurs in the wilderness. Buddha had to go to the wilderness to experience nirvana and self-realization. Muhammad had to go to the wilderness of Mount Hira in 609 and climb to the summit in the middle of the night and wrestle an angel there to have the Quran squeezed from him. Moses had to go to the wilderness of Mount Sinai for 40 days alone to get the commandments. The Jews had to spend 40 years wandering the wilderness to purge themselves of the 400 years of slavery in Egypt. Christ had to go to the wilderness for 40 days to discover his divinity for the first time. His mentor was John the Baptist, who lived in a cave in the Jordan Valley and dressed in the skins of wild beasts and ate locusts and honey. And all of Christ's parables were taken from nature. I am the vine, you are the branches. The mustard seed, the little swallows, the scattering the seeds on the fallow ground, the lilies of the field. He called himself a fisherman, a farmer, a vineyard keeper, a shepherd. And the reason he did that, and it's the same reason all the Old Testament prophets did it, the Talmudic prophets, the Quranic prophets, the Upanishad prophets, all the way back to the pagan prophets like Aesop, all of them came out of the wilderness. And all of them used parables and allegories and fables drawn from nature to teach us the difference between right and wrong as morality plays, to teach us what the face of God looks like. And the reason they did that is that they were revolutionaries. They were revolting against the fundamentalism, the power, fundamentalist power structures of their own time. And they would have been dismissed as quacks because they were saying things that contradicted everything that the common people had heard from the literate, sophisticated people of their time. But they were able to listen to these parables and look at nature and confirm the wisdom of these parables through their own observations of the fishes and the birds. And they were able to say, he's not telling us something new. He's simply illuminating something very, very old, messages that were written into creation by the Creator at the beginning of time. And we haven't been able to discern or decipher them until the prophets came along, who had immersed themselves in wilderness and learned its language and come back to the cities to teach us the wisdom of God. This is where our values come from, our most essential human spiritual values. And in our country, it's where our values come.